Hei og velkommen til Økonominyhetene. Det blitt torsdag 19. april. Mitt navn Stein Ove Haugen. Resultatsesongen så smått i gang, og neste uke legger 47 selskaper fram kvartalstall, og mange investorer spente på hva de kan forvente fra de ulike selskapene. Det vet Pinpoint Estimates en god del om, og vi har med oss administrerende direktør i selskapet, Natasha Belinska, om litt. Men aller først litt om det som skjer i markedene. Oljeprisen den bryter ned gjennom den tekniske støtten på 87-nivået. Og det åpner kanskje for en enda litt større nedgang. Den har falt tilbake fra i overkant av 92 dollar forrige fredag til da den tekniske støtten på 87-nivået, og som da testes nå. Hovedindeksen har også korrigert ned fra all time high forrige fredag på 1376,17 til dagens 1331,95, og det betyr at hovedindeksen er ned 0,8% i dag, og det betyr også at antallet all time high så langt i år stoppet på 9, i hvert fall foreløpig. Kronen har samtidig svekket seg, og en dollar koster nå 11 kroner og 5 øre. En euro koster 11 kroner og 77 øre. Oljefondet det påvirkes jo av kronen og valutakursen, men kronesvekkelsen oppveier for fallet i markedene ute og ligger fremdeles over 17.300 milliarder kroner. På børsen i Europa så er det ned, ja, stort sett ned over hele linja, ned 0,4 til 0,7%. I London så er det ned 0,7, i Frankfurt er det ned 0,7%, i Paris er det ned 0,3%, i Milano ned 0,3, i Madrid ned 0,7, og da er Stoxx 600 ned 0,5%. Vi kan også ta med at 10-årsrenten den snuste jo på 4,70% tirsdag, og er i dag på, skal vi se her om vi finner den i farta, i dag ligger den på 4,60, altså 4,60 blank, så den er da ned en god del fra det høyeste på 4,70 nesten da på tirsdag. Toårsrensen den har snudd på 5% hele uken, og det snakkes om at det trolig blir færre rentekutt enn tidligere i USA, og det kommer senere at de kommer senere enn tidligere ventet. Noen advarer også om at neste renteendring kan bli en heving fra dagens 5,25 til 5,5% i USA. På børsen i New York så ligger an til å åpne litt ned til flatt. Dow Jones er svagt opp, i hvert fall så indikeres det at den kommer til å åpne svagt opp 0,06% til 37.775. S&P 500 ligger an til å åpne ned 0,2% til 5.011, mens Nasdaq ligger an til å åpne ned 0,5% til 15.601. Og vi kan også ta med da at Bitcoin er opp 2,2% til 64.951 dollar, mens Ethereum er opp 1% til 3.100 dollar. Vi kan også ta med, hvis vi finner, gullprisene fant vi ikke her i farten. Men før vi tar inn dagens første gjest og dagens eneste gjest, vil jeg bare minne om at hvis du ikke rekker å se denne sendingen, så kan du også høre den ved å søke opp Økonominyhetene på Spotify, på Apple og på finansavisen.no/podcast. Men før vi tar inn gjesten, så skal vi ta litt fra Oslo Børs. Og her er det nedgang for 9 av de 10 mest omsatte aksjene. På toppen så påvirkes da selvfølgelig Equinor av oljeprisen, så olje og Equinor er da ned 2,7%. Aker BP faller 2,2%. Så har vi også nedgang da for Frontline 1,8% ned. Vår Energi faller 2,2%, og ellers så er det nedgang på 0,4% for Yara, 0,4% på Hydro, og Orkla er ned 9,4%. Selskapet har delt ut utbytte i dag på 6 kroner, men aksjen faller litt mer enn det. Polite skal hente 160 millioner kroner til en kurs på 2,31 kroner per aksje. Aksjen faller 27%, og så langt i år er aksjen med det ned nesten 90%. Norske Skog la frem tall for første kvartal fredag morgen. Det viste svakere resultater enn ventet. Fasit ble resultat før av- og nedskrivninger altså EBITDA, på 76 millioner kroner. DNB Markets analytiker Johannes Gruselius forventet en EBITDA på 93 millioner kroner. Elkem falt 5,8% i går til 19,64 kroner. Kvartalstallene torsdag morgen viste svakere omsetning enn ventet og et underskudd etter skatt på 414 millioner kroner. Og fredag stiger aksjen en knapp prosent. Norwegian faller 3-4% til rundt 16 kroner. Carnegie tror betydelig høyere oljepris og svak krone kan ramme flyselskapet, og kuttet kursmålet med 2 kroner torsdag til 20 kroner. Atlantic Sapphire la fram tall for 2023 etter børsens stengetid i går. Selskapet viste til et årsunderskudd før skatt på 137,7 millioner dollar, ned fra et underskudd på 65 millioner dollar i 2022. Omsetningen endte på 14 millioner dollar etter et slaktevolum på 1545 tonn laks. Og aksjen den er også da en av taperne på Oslo Børs i dag, faller nå 6,7% til 89 øre. Softox er opp etter gårsdagens investorpresentasjon, men er fremdeles ned 93% så langt i år. Og som sagt, Orkla noteres da X-utbytte på 6 kroner. Da blir det litt egenreklame. Finansavisen har inngått et samarbeid med Pinpoint Estimates, som samler inn estimater fra rundt 10 000 investorer hvert kvartal. Estimatene er nå tilgjengelig i børstjenesten på finansavisen.no, og vi har med oss administrerende direktør Natasha Belinsky i Pinpoint. Welcome, Natasha.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Yeah, could you start with give us an introduction to Pinpoint Estimates?
Yeah, sure. So Pinpoint Estimates is a platform that collects forward-looking financial estimates for publicly traded companies. And we've been active in Sweden for the last 3 years. We have just under 12,000 registered users on the platform. And the way it works basically is that different types of investors or individuals interested in stocks would submit their own estimates for the companies that they follow or that they have an interest in. Most often it's the estimates are on two KPIs, net sales and EBIT. And as soon as you submit your estimates, you get access to Pinpoint Consensus, which in essence is similar to traditional consensus, but it's based on estimates from a more kind of diverse group of people. And most often it's based on more estimates, so a bigger data set. And now, as from what I understood in Norwegian, you said that we are starting this partnership collaboration. We are introducing the service in Norway. This will be our first market outside Sweden. So super excited about that.
So I understand that Pinpoint is a Swedish company.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where did it all start? How come up? Did you come up with the idea or did you come in later?
I came in a little bit later. There was a group of enthusiasts who kind of are interested in stocks and in the stock market as such. And they could see a gap on the market, both in terms of like the information was available, like there wasn't fairness in how information was available to different players on the stock market. So a smaller group of people had access to more information. So the idea was both in terms of kind of introducing the transparency and fairness into the financial market so that anyone can get access to the forward-looking data on the market, but also kind of to change this paradigm where when media, for example, speak about market expectations, they only refer to analysts, and it's not only analysts. I guess from what I know in Norway, the market has been developing in the same way as in Sweden in terms of retail investors entering the market at a very high speed. From what I could see in Norway, the number of retail investors increased by 50% in the last 5 years. So it's a group, this group of investors is constantly growing. So we believe it's important to collect their expectations as well, because they are the ones who buy and sell stocks on the everyday basis, and they influence the stock price. So it's important to know about their expectations, both for investors, other investors, but also for companies who have the responsibility to create transparency and fair expectation view.
Do all the 13,000 investors contribute with their estimates?
So we look at our data quarterly. Of course, some people leave some estimates and then they disappear and then they come back. But on a quarterly basis, we have around between 2,000 and 3,000 people submitting their estimates. Okay. So if I kind of, out of those 12,000, everyone has submitted estimates sometime in the past, but they are not active every quarter, to be clear.
But the idea is that you have to contribute with the estimates to get the consensus estimate.
Exactly. That's how it works. So it's completely free for the investors, but you have to submit your estimate to get access to consensus. Yes.
When did all this start? When did you start up?
We've been active in Sweden for 3 years. So it's a completely new product. So it was built in around 2019, 2020, and we've been collecting data since 2021.
So how did you get from zero to 13,000?
I guess it was a good kind of macro situation with the corona and people coming into the stock market. So I think we kind of tapped into that, but mostly organically, actually. So we have our Twitter channel where we post interesting insights and data about different companies. But we didn't do much marketing. I think the need for the forward-looking data is so high that people kind of, word of mouth and social media and all those channels helped us to establish in Sweden.
How much has been invested in Pinpoint estimates so far?
In the company, you mean?
Yeah.
It's so around 15 million Swedish crowns.
Okay. So now you're working with Finansavisen here in Norway.
Yes.
What do you expect from this cooperation?
Yeah, so as I said, this is a kind of entry into a new market. And our hope is to offer our service where investors already are. And we know that Finansavisen invested quite a lot into building new valuable tools for the investors. You provide a lot of valuable historical data already on your website. So the idea is to kind of capture the investors where they already are and offer them forward-looking data alongside historical data. Our ambition as a company to create the same transparency in expectations in Norway as we have been working on in Sweden. And we have the same high ambitions when it comes to both volume and quality of data in Norway.
The main thing is your consensus estimates. And
yeah. You
are crowdsourcing this from the investors that registered on your platform. How do you measure or calculate this consensus estimate?
Good question. Yes, so it's not a straightforward average. It is a weighted average where we look at the different users' precision. So basically, if you have been a user of Pinpoint, you have submitted some estimates and they have come close to the actual reported values, you will have higher precision. And that will make that your estimate will be weighed higher in the Pinpoint consensus. So we have several algorithms that look at your precision globally on the platform, independent of the company, precision for a specific sector. So we have users who are really good at gaming or industry or technology. And then you have a precision for a specific company. So all those three are taken into consideration when we make the weighing in of the consensus.
Do you have a routine for deleting estimates that are obviously way off?
Yes and no. We have an algorithm that weighs down outlier estimates to the point that they don't affect the consensus. So we don't delete, but they are not taken into consideration in the consensus.
Hmm. And the quality of the investors and the estimates are based on historic numbers,
yeah,
and estimates
it's
that
based
you have.
On the, yeah, so as I said, the better you are at leaving estimates, the more your estimates will weigh in the consensus. However, we do some checks of the quality and relevance of our data, of course, and we do that by comparing our precision against analysts where the data is available. And we have seen that in 57% of cases, our consensus is closer to the actual reported values than analysts. So that gives us confidence to say that our data is at least as good as analysts.
Mm. At least as good as who?
Analysts.
Bloomberg?
no, I don't know. I mean, those analysts that follow Swedish companies. So we've been doing those checks for Swedish companies so far.
Mm. It doesn't seem that you have an estimate for earnings per share. Why is that?
Well, I mean, we... And maybe I should mention like how we monetize to give some context. So far, we've been selling the data to companies as an investor relations tool so that the companies can also understand what expectations are out there, if they are off or if they're in line, and give companies the possibility to act proactively and communicate with the market, maybe explain some things in the report, or maybe adjust the tone of voice in the report and things like that. And the companies actually would like to get VP,
the EPS,
that number, EPS, sorry, I was mixing with the Swedish one, EPS. But we have seen that for investors, it's one more step in their calculation process, and to be able to collect the data from more investors, to make it more available and accessible for more investors, we decided to keep it at EBIT level. Okay. Because that one is a bit easier to calculate.
So, I believe many investors are looking for just this EPS. Is this something that is coming, or...?
Yes, so what we're looking at the kind of in the future is adding more more KPIs, and primarily we're looking at some kind of profit KPI to give kind of the real bottom line to our users, so that you can, for example, calculate PE value based on the future on the future profit numbers. So this is something that is coming in the future.
You said these estimates are free for those who share their estimates.
Yeah.
What is your business model? Where does your income come from?
As I shortly mentioned, currently we sell this data as investor relations tool. So the company, the listed companies, get access to those expectations beforehand, before the reports, so that they have a bit of forewarning, so they know, like, you know, they sit with the actual numbers a bit before the report actually is released, so they have some time to prepare, they have some time to maybe communicate some things, they have time to adjust tone of voice in the report. But actually, we now, after being active for 3 years, we have quite a lot of data, so we are looking at new business models, so like selling our data as a data feed. To, for example, different investor tools and other tools that work with this kind of data.
How many companies do you offer these estimates for now?
So we cover all Nordic companies at the moment. In terms of, like, all companies are available on the platform for investors to go and add their estimates. But Consensus, we are collecting that for around 300 Swedish companies at the moment. And when we speak of Consensus at Pinpoint, we consider at least 8 estimates to be a consensus. So we need at least 8 estimates when we speak of Consensus. And that we have for 300 Swedish companies.
Hmm. And just a few companies from Norway yet, or?
Sure, it's early days for us in Norway, of course. But it seems like we have a kind of winner in terms of popularity, and it's Kitron. The last time I checked today, they had 60 estimates, which is, I mean, quite a lot for a company that came into the platform not that long ago. There are some other companies that seem to be quite popular, like Aker, VP, Norbit, Bouvet, Oldfield Technology, that have around like between 15 and 20 estimates at the moment. So we are quite optimistic about Norwegian market as well. And it is early days, but I'll have to come back and see what data we have ahead of Q2.
Hmm. You say that 8 companies and 8 estimates is enough to make a consensus estimate.
Yeah.
What is the ideal number?
I mean, I would say 8. That's where we saw that the data becomes reliable. Then in some cases, we can see that, I mean, the more you have, the more representative it is, of course, that gives us more kind of confidence to say that we are actually representing the whole broad market. But when it comes to kind of real data analysis, what we've seen, 8 is enough for a reliable consensus.
Okay, so now it's Sweden, it's 300 companies, and Norway is coming. What's next?
Well, as I said, we already have all Nordic companies on the platform, so we will be launching a similar partnership in Finland together with a partner called Inderes, who have the biggest investor community in Finland. So we are planning to do something similar to what we're doing in Norway with Finansavisen in Finland. So Finland will be next.
And then maybe Denmark?
And then maybe Denmark. As I said, we already have the companies. We're looking for the correct partner there. But yes, that's the plan, to cover the whole Nordic markets.
And when you enter Germany?
We'll see. I cannot promise anything now, but of course it's a market that we are looking into, considering its size. It is a quite, how would you say it, conservative market in many senses. People, especially retail, like, they are not they are not as used to invest in high risk products. But we are looking at Germany as one of the companies. And I cannot promise any dates.
Except from the established companies, do you have any real competitors that are similar to yours?
Not anyone who does exactly the same as us. There is a company in the US called Estimize that crowdsources estimates in the same way. They have a different business model, but they crowdsource in a similar way.
Thank you for taking the time, Natasha. And good
Thank luck. You. It was nice being here. Thank you.
Yeah. Bye-bye. Ja, da skal vi begynne å runde av her. Vi kan ta med at hovedindeksen på Oslo Børs, den er ned som i sted, ned 0,8% til 1332. Oljeprisen, den er nå på brent spot, det er på $86.05. Det er bare en uke siden den var på $92. Så da er vi ned $6 så langt på en uke. Equinor er ned 2,6%, Aker BP ned 2%, og Vår Energi ned 2,1%. Og den amerikanske lettoljen, den er på $81.59. I Finansavisen i morgen kan du lese Trygve Egners leder om den nye i Arbeiderpartiet, som nå bestemmer alt. Makroskatt og innsideporteføljen, selvfølgelig. Vi tar også med på innsiden av Kjell Inge Røkkes teknologiverksted til Ånna, som selger 190 tonn vertikaldyrket salat til restaurant- og dagligvaremarkedet, og til DNB Wealth Management, som har et aktivt kundeforhold til mer enn 60% av alle de rikeste på Kapital 400-listen, og mye, mye mer. Det var økonominyheten her på Finansavisen fredag 19. april. Vi er tilbake igjen her med Børsmorgen på mandag klokken 8.55 og økonominyhetene klokken 14.30. De siste nyhetene i økonomi, næringsliv, børs og finans får du gjennom hele dagen på finansavisen.no. Mitt navn er Stein Ove Haugen. Tusen takk for at du så på og hørte på. Riktig god helg, og håper du er med oss igjen på mandag også.